Hello everyone, welcome to Manifest IES. This is Manjunath, Polity Faculty at Manifest, and I also handle Political Science optional here. Earlier I had done a discussion on paper 1 of Political Science, that is 2019 paper. It was an offline discussion, the video which I had posted. And I had also promised that I would be doing the second paper discussion, but I couldn't do because there was overwhelming work in offline works. I was caught up in those, so couldn't do the video at that particular point in time. So extremely sorry that I couldn't do it at that point in time. And after which many students also made a request to do that. So now that I've got time, I have thought of doing the second paper discussion as well. So this video is quite a lengthy one, wherein I'll be discussing every aspect of the question, and also I'll be making certain observations in general. So let me explain the format of the video first. First, I'll be picking up all the questions, giving you the format of the answer. Second part of the video will be about general observations on the paper itself. So what are the cues you should be taking from the paper? What could be the likely areas that can be focused on in the upcoming examination? And third part will be about the strategy, as to what strategy you should be following depending on the observations I made in the second part. And when I said first part, I'll be discussing the question and answer. There is a format for it also. The format is what every question I'll be first doing, I'll be placing it in the syllabus. When I place it in the syllabus, what does it do? This is extremely important, because once you link it with the syllabus, you'll get to know that how or where the questions are being picked from, where the areas are being focused, or which areas are being focused on, what could be the areas which could be focused on in the upcoming years. So this will help you analyze your gray areas as well. So once I put it in the syllabus, then I'll give you the format of the answer, entire answer. After that, I'll be making general observations on the question. So every question will be having these three parts or these three patterns. So let us start with the discussion, and before entering the discussion, I would the PDFs of these slides which I'm using for discussion will also be available for download, the links for which are posted in the comment and the description section. Now, also one more thing is, when I discuss an answer, I usually do it in parts, part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4. But the point you have to remember with respect to optionals is, there is a small difference between how a GS answer is written and an optional answer is written. Optional answers are preferred in paragraphs. In GS answer, you usually go for a point format. So when I'm making parts, this is just for my convenience. You're not making the same kind of parts there. So when I say part basically refers to one specific chunk as a paragraph. So part, if there are four parts, there are four different chunks which are written in large paragraphs. This is the entire idea. So part wise system is for my convenience, because it makes explanation scientific. It will also help you analyze as to what parts are missing, what parts are not missing. Though the style of analyzing questions in GS and optionals is the same, that is part wise method, but the presentation differs. Now, as far as presentation, how do you present, etc., and all, I'll give you hints in some questions, and also I'll be doing certain videos on question answers in political sense, as to what kind of how do you answer a particular question, what are the different kinds of questions that can be asked in poll sense. Those I'll be doing in subsequent videos. In this video, I'll be just restricted to the paper discussion. So let us start with the discussion. The first question is, discuss the utility of nuclear deterrence theory in the context of recent standoff between India and Pakistan.
Subscribe now and press the bell icon. Never miss an update.
Well, let us place it in the syllabus. Where has it been picked from? So then it is in part A of paper 1. So it is under the topic contemporary global concerns. There is a topic called nuclear proliferation. It has been picked from them. Second part B is, I mean, it is also related to part B. So you are writing an answer which is a mix of both. So it is, so certain aspects of part B are taken and certain aspects of part A are taken, then it is posed as a question. So impediments to regional cooperation, India-Pakistan relation, India and the nuclear question, what is India's policy towards nuclear issues? All these three are related to this question. So what is the observation I'm making here? UPSC has stopped recognizing or differentiating between part A and part B. Part A questions are being mixed with part B. Part B questions are being mixed with part A. And this is more likely to occur in 10 mark questions. So keep this trend in mind. I'll be coming to this trend again. Now, how do you answer this question? So first part of this question should be the context of the issue. This has been asked in the context of India-Pakistan standoff. When you say India-Pakistan standoff, what does it mean? There was the Pulwama attack, and then India retaliated. After the retaliation, Pakistan did not take any counter action. It literally stopped there. Escalation did not happen. So the question what it is asking, it is saying whether nuclear deterrence theory offers a sufficient explanation for this standoff, for this escalation, de-escalation. So escalation did not occur to a full-fledged war. Why it didn't occur? If it did not occur, does nuclear deterrence theory offer an explanation, is basically this question asking about. So first is write the context of the issue, talk about Pulwama attack, retaliation, the new normal wherein India entered the border of other country, but it did not escalate into a full-fledged war. So this is the context of the issue you are explaining. So in this context, there were also statements made by the ministers. Minister of Defense Rajnath Singh said that India will no longer follow the no first policy. So first you introduce that and then come to second part where you have to discuss the theory. So when you're writing the first paragraph, talk about how, talking about the context, also talk about it is to be examined whether nuclear deterrence actually helped. So with this, you end that paragraph, moving to part two. In part two, you're explaining what is nuclear deterrence and types. Now, one point I would like to make, this question is in part A, it is a theory answer. Since it is a theory answer, it's theoretical aspect. Part A is always theoretical aspect. Part B is your practical aspects or the praxis. So when there is a theoretical aspect, it becomes your duty to give all theoretical aspects related to theory being asked. So many people do not focus on this. They directly jump to India-Pakistan relations, how it could have, why it did not escalate, etc. But if you do not give theory, this question does not make any sense to me, because UPSC, if it didn't want nuclear deterrence to be explained, this question should have been asked in part B. So keep this in mind, nuclear deterrence you have to explain. Basically, what is nuclear deterrence? Deterring from attacking a particular country or prohibiting a country from attacking other country through nuclear weapons. So if you have it, so this entire logic is based on the logic of fear. Now, well, so the other country fears that this country A has nuclear weapons, hence it is not attacking. So once you give the definition, the famous thinker of this is Kenneth Walsh. He was the person who gave nuclear deterrence theory with respect to the idea of mutually assured destruction. Now the theory does not end here. You have to explain nuclear deterrence could occur in different ways. It could occur through MAD, mutually assured destruction. That is, if you attack me, I will attack you, and it will lead to mutual destruction of both. So that is MAD. This was given by Kenneth Walsh. Nuclear utilization target selection. This was given by Herman Kahn. In MAD, nuclear weapons are not used. It is just the idea that somebody has nuclear weapons that itself prevents a person from or a country from attacking. But in nuts, what it says, a country should use its nuclear weapons. There should be tactical nuclear missiles, and these missiles should directly target the nuclear installations or nuclear missiles of the other country. So this is a kind of surgical strike which attacks the nuclear weapons of the other country only. So this is another kind of nuclear deterrence. Nuclear deterrence by denial, there is one more thing. Nuclear deterrence by denial refers to, that is, an attack can be prevented if you have a missile shield. Nuclear deterrence by preemptive strike, this was followed by US under George Bush, wherein you attack before the country attacks you. That is called preemptive strike. So these are different kinds of nuclear deterrence. Just make a mention of these three. You need not explain. For us, this is more important. This you explain in detail, mutually assured destruction, because India has this capacity, mutually assured destruction. India does not subscribe to this idea. Nuclear first policy rests on mutually assured destruction. So once you explain this, give the thinker Kenneth Waltz and make a mention of these three with the mention of Herman Kahn. This will fetch you a lot of marks when you give theory properly. Now, after this, part three will be what? Whether nuclear deterrence was the only reason. So in part three, what you have to write is nuclear deterrence could be one of the reasons, but it cannot be considered as the only reason or the sole reason, because nuclear power, India acquired nuclear power status long back in 1998 only. Despite that, Pakistan has made repeated attacks. Terrorist attacks have continued. So this clearly shows that deterrence or nuclear deterrence is not effective against Pakistan. What are the reasons for that? That you have to give. So part three talks about that, why it might not be the only reason. So first is, there is no central decision making authority. There is a deep state. Pakistan has a state within a state. We don't know who is the ruling authority there. So when we don't know who is the ruling authority, what happens is, who do you instill fear in? There is no government to instill fear in. There is no rationality which is involved in that. So nuclear deterrence does not work. Second is, deterrence does not work against terrorists. For deterrence to work, it works on the principle of logic of fear, is what I made a mention. So there is a need. So if you are afraid of something, you should be rational to be afraid of a particular thing. But terrorists are irrational. They are brainwashed candidates. Rationalism does not work with them. They come as suicide bombers. So endangering their lives does not work for them. So deterrence for them does not work. That is another reason why nuclear deterrence may not be the reason. Third is, terrorists believe in low intensity warfare. So when they believe in low intensity warfare, India's nuclear deterrence does not work, because India believes in no first use policy, meaning when you are attacked in a nuclear way, you will be retaliating in a nuclear way. So terrorists who do not use nuclear weapons, they use nuclear intensity warfare. Nuclear weapons which India has does not make any use, or does not have any use value with respect to terrorists. So these are the, and this is the analysis you are giving, so that it is not particularly applicable with respect to some. Logic might have worked, some fear it might have instilled, but not completely, is what you are explaining. Part 4, if nuclear deterrence did not work, what exactly worked? There are many other factors that led to a standoff. First thing is, the first point is guilt of being the first violator. So it is Pakistan which had made the first attack. So irrespective of what kind of a country it is, it was the first violator. Since it was in the wrong in the first place, it attracted severe criticism from different corners of the world. It could impact Pakistan's diplomatic clout in completely. Hence, there was certain kind of reservations on the part of Pakistan. Second is, since it was the first violator, international pressure was built. And more importantly, certain countries which were considered very close to it did not express open help aid. US is not the same with Pakistan today as it was earlier after the global war on terror. Trump is not so favorable compared to other presidents towards Pakistan. That also played a role. And India's diplomatic clout with respect to China. So India immediately reached out to China for China's help and China's support on this issue. So China also go considered as all-weather friend of Pakistan, did not vocally support Pakistan. That was other reason. And also, economic condition of Pakistan is completely busted. There is no economic strength involved. It is in huge debts, completely dependent on external debts, completely dependent on external institutions as well. So this also played a role, that in case it went for war, there should be a diversion of resources into military. And also, when you look at when I was speaking about international pressure, you will also see that materialization of international pressure, because it is immediately after that terrorism becomes a big issue, and later it materializes into grey listing of Pakistan and also Masood Azhar being listed under the UN Sanctions Committee. So all these played a key role for the standoff. It was not just nuclear deterrence is what is the argument you're making. So with this, we have done the first question. I would like to make two observations in this question. First observation is, this question is a mix of both theory and practice. So earlier it used to so happen that questions which were particularly, I mean, completely theory based would be asked. They wouldn't expect you to know so many examples related to the theory. And in part B, explicitly practice or praxis questions would be asked. Now this is a new trend where they're picking up small event or an event or a significant event, and then they are linking with one particular theory and asking as a composite question. So this is a very, very significant trend as to what you should be doing for theory and practice questions when they ask such questions. That I'll be discussing at the end when I give inputs related to the overall paper. Next is current. This is a current inspired event, and I would also like to make an observation that 90% of the questions in paper 2 were current events. This shows how dynamic the paper has become. What you should be doing for that, that also I'll be discussing later. Next is second question. Write a brief note on 17th NAM summit in Venezuela. And this is a question directly extracted from the syllabus. If you place it in the syllabus, in part A, it is basically part A topic only. Here it is, the topic is changing international political order, rise of superpowers, strategic and ideological bipolarity, arms race, cold war. So it is under this you study in NAM. So remember, it is not an India specific question. They have not asked what was the role of India in this one. They have just asked 17th NAM summit. So you can also link with part B, not specifically related to part B though. Part B, there is an explicit mention of NAM, its movement, India's contribution to it. So that is part B is India specific NAM. Now in this one, what are the observations and all that we'll be making? What are the parts in this answer? First is introduce NAM summit. So it is, see here it is directly asking you, so what, write a short note. It is just a note on 17th NAM summit, and also they have given you this place as well, Venezuela. So you have to be more specific in terms of giving facts. This is what the question is demanding. If you write a general answer, you're not going to get marks. So what are the points you're writing that I'll be discussing? Part one will be what? Talk about the summit, where it was held. Be even more specific than the question. So 17th NAM summit was held in Margarita Island, Venezuela in 2006. Talk about the theme also. So peace, sovereignty and solidarity for development is the theme of this. It is and in this, what was the outcome of this? A 21 article declaration was issued. Now in part two, explain the declaration. Here your knowledge regarding NAM could be used, because NAM usually talks about the same things. So those same things were agreed to during the summit also, and also whenever NAM meets, it will deal with the topical issues also. When I say topical issues, what does it mean? It means issues which are burning topics during that summit will be discussed. So basically it talks about what? It talks about disarmament, it talks about climate change, it talks about environmental issues, it talks about nuclear non-proliferation, it talks about refugee issues in the region, it talks about overall global politics. So these are the general issues it talks about. 21 articles, out of which even if you give 7 to 8 solid articles or solid issues like climate change, disarmament, democracy, human rights, so global issues it speaks about, Syrian crisis, West Asian refugee crisis, so all these are the issues it speaks about. So you can just guess them generally, but make it very precise while presenting it. Now the question was asked because there was a specific motivation behind this. India did not attend the summit. That was the trigger for this question. So at the end, what you could do is just make a mention, don't discuss in detail because the question is not particularly dealing with it. But if you don't write also, that it becomes incomplete. Just make a mention saying that India did not participate in the summit. After this, in 18th summit also it did not participate. So this represents this reflects or this shows a change in Indian priorities or priorities of India. India, though believes in the idea of non-alignment, it has stopped believing in the organization in total. As an institution, it has stopped believing, but non-alignment as an idea remains, it continues even today. How and all we'll discuss in Ocean Diplomacy. So this is what you're writing at the end, part three. So these are the points you are discussing. Now, what are the observations in this question? How do you get more marks? So first thing is, it is again a current event. I told you 90% of the questions are current event. It was connected with India. That was why this question is asked. How do you fetch more marks? Here the marks you are fetching will be more if you are writing specific points related to the articles, if you are writing specific points like theme, Margaret Island, etc. If you are very general in terms, if you have not written the theme, if you have written general points that NAM believes this, etc. and all, there is a less likeliness of getting marks because the examiner will get the hint that you have not read it, you just know what NAM is and you have made up an answer. It will fetch marks, but not those higher marks which you want. Next is, in what way does the predominance of USA in the UN funding affect its decision making? 10 mark question again. So where do you place it in the syllabus? It is part A. United Nations is one topic which is separately mentioned. It talks about envisaged role and actual record. So, but if you specifically place it, it is for need for UN reforms. So one of the problems in UN is UN funding. So there is a need to change the funding pattern. That is the question. So one issue was in news, which is a current issue only which has been picked up. Because Trump has stopped funding. What are the parts you are writing? First is introduce the context. Context is Trump has threatened of dire consequences to the UN. If it does not fall in line with the demands of UN, line with the demands made by US. So in this context, UN has been facing problems in terms of its functioning. Once you introduce the context, talk about types of funding. This is the most important part. Generally, students directly give a very general, broader or hazy idea talking about funding, US dominates funding of UN, that everybody knows. Because that is how US is controlling it. But you have to talk about what are the types of funding given to it. So the question is basically focusing on what way does the predominance of USA in funding affect the decision making. So how does it affect, that we'll discuss. But what are the types of funding in UN? There are two types of funding to UN. One is the compulsory, the obligatory funding. Second kind of funding is the voluntary funding. What is compulsory or obligatory funding? This is determined on the basis of your economic size. So on the basis of economic size, when it is determined, it's a complex formula. Other factors are also involved. So US becomes the largest funder, contributor to the budget. And there is also something called voluntary. So beyond this, also a country may voluntarily fund. A philanthropist also may fund, NGOs may fund, etc. Even in that, even in the voluntary funding, US is the major contributor. So US is a major contributor both in voluntary and obligatory funding is what you are writing. After which you are talking about US dominance. So US dominance is not an issue of today. It has become very explicit under Trump, but US dominance under US and starts with 1991 after the collapse of USSR is what you are introducing. So this gives you a historical basis. Your answer becomes even more beautiful because if you just focus on events like Trump, your knowledge remains shallow and it will give a it will not make so strong an impact on the evaluator. So talk about 1991 when it started. After that, funding gives its power, that is okay. More importantly, veto power is one thing, and third is unipolar world after 1990s. All this combined together and makes UN dominance possible, US dominance possible. After this, talk about the impacts. This is the question we are addressing. How does it affect the decision making? So how does it affect? It affects decision making. First is all important decisions are taken by UNSC. So with UN being the sole contributor to the budget or the highest contributor, all decision makings have to be favorable. So it may lead to arm twisting of other permanent members to fall in line. In case other members are vetoing its decision, it will not be possible because US may threaten of dire consequences. And also when this happens, decision making will be pro US So it will be ideologically prejudiced. When you say ideologically prejudiced, was US kind of democracy will be promoted, US kind of human rights will be promoted. So it won't be a democracy indigenous to West Asia, a democracy indigenous to India. It will be a Western imposition of ideologies. And more importantly, what will happen, peacekeeping process also will not be very peacekeeping process will also not be neutral. When you say peacekeeping process, so someone has the power, economic and political power. So when they are having the economic decision making is in their hand, so despite India being the major contributor in peacekeeping force, it does not have a decision making power. So it US will order India's peacekeeping force to according to its whims and fancies. This is another impact. So socio-economic development will also be affected. I'll give a best example of this. UNESCO was trying to help the Palestinian refugees. In that case, and UNESCO also had given up a membership to Palestine. So what did UN do? UN stopped the funding to UNESCO. So what will happen through this socio-economic developmental process of UN also gets affected. And more importantly, when US is the sole economic and political power, what will happen is ICJ also cannot function independently. The best example is US conflict with Nicaragua islands. There was a conflict between the two, which I'll discuss in ICJ. Though the decision was given by ICJ, US did not accept it. It violated or it went against the judgment blatantly. It was completely impudent in its behavior. So these are the points you're giving. So where do you get more marks? You're getting marks when you are explaining with examples like Nicaragua, you're giving example of UNESCO, etc., peacekeeping process, India's role as peacekeeper, but no role, no power in decision making, etc. So overall, what it leads to affecting the multilateral principles. So this is the explanation of part 3. Now part 4 give a conclusion, summarize it. Since the 10 marker, don't give it don't speak about it at length. What you say is there is a need for a broader funding base for UN, and also there is a need for UNSA reforms. Wider representation to different countries will actually create a balance against US is what you are concluding. Now, since the question is in part A, certain observations I would like to make regarding how you do fetch more marks. What are the things if you write, you'll be getting more marks. First observation regarding the question is, it's a current event. Second is, types of funding if you are writing, you'll be getting more marks. If you are writing theoretical, giving theoretical integration, then you'll be getting more marks. What are the theories related to this? What are the different theories you can link? US is the sole power. It has both political power and economic power is what I said. That is, it has political power through UNSA veto. It has economic power because it is funding also. So it's a combination of what Marx calls as the base and the superstructure, which is very clearly dealt by Marxist paradigms. Many Marxist thinkers who approach IR, they say that Bretton Woods institutions and UN are nothing but controlled are nothing but institutions which are pawns in the hands of the developed countries. So this idea you can use to explain in part B. So when I was explaining part 3, in this you can talk about giving the theory. So US dominance when you are giving part 2, in even US dominance when you're speaking, talk about these theories. And also at the end, you can, when you are saying reforms, you can write a line wherein if reforms are not done, if the reforms are not undertaken, then the realist call, the realist projection or the prognosis which was given, it realists believe that institutions or international institutions are dominated by single one countries or a single country or the developed countries, and they are burdened. See, these developed countries are burdened due to these international institutions, and over a period this international institution will collapse. They will become dysfunctional if it is dependent on one country. So at the end you could give of a realist take where you say if reforms are not imminent, then the realist projection or prognosis that UN or international institutions will collapse due to overburdening on developed countries will come true. So these are the theoretical fine integrations you can make here and there. Now these integrations is my creativity or my ingenuity to to make the answer beautiful. Now, you could bring many kinds of theories. I've given you just some examples as to how do you make an answer better, because generally everybody will be writing US is dominant, etc. But how do you differentiate your answer from others? These are the inputs which I'm giving with respect to that particular answer. Next is, evaluate the role of BIMSTEC in multi-sectoral technical and economic cooperation. So this, the syllabus is regionalization of world politics. There is an observation you have to make. This organization has not been explicitly mentioned anywhere. So this is a new development. We'll discuss more of this. Certain organizations which are prominently impacting Indian foreign policy are being asked despite not being explicitly mentioned in the syllabus. So such organizations you have to prepare henceforth is the observation. Now what it is asking specific role of BIMSTEC in technical and economic cooperation. If you write general answer like BIMSTEC is this, BIMSTEC is that, without focusing on technical and economic, you are not going to get marks. You have to focus only on the technical and the economic cooperation part. So it is, the word is evaluate. Evaluation also you have to do. So first part will be BIMSTEC. You give an introduction. It's a regional organization, Bay of Bengal Multisectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation, established in 1997. And the members you can give, and also its headquarters you can give, Nepal Kathmandu, established in 1997. So it was mainly established, or it was established or as an initiative for, it was an initiative undertaken as an alternative to SAARC when SAARC was not functioning due to the obstructionist policies followed by Pakistan. Once you give this introduction, part two, talk about technical and economic cooperation. What are the technical and economic cooperation? It mainly focuses on the following things. First is, economic cooperation and technical cooperation refers to all this. So there is, BIMSTEC has proposed a so before this, one theory you could introduce. The theory is functionalism theory. BIMSTEC is based on the idea of functionalism. It aims to focus on technical cooperation and economic cooperation, just as functionalists propose. Because political cooperation is difficult to attain, it brings non-issues into it and it makes the entire regional organization dysfunctional. Hence, giving this theory, BIMSTEC was proposed as a functionalist organization, taking the or learning from the faults of SAARC. SAARC did not function because political issues became very predominant. Hence, BIMSTEC tried a new method, tried a new theory called the functionalist theory. That is, so we can talk about, give certain thinkers, Ernest Haas, David Mitrani, etc. David Mitrani is the thinker. So what are the technical and economic cooperation you're talking about? FTA was proposed in 2004. Connectivity, it basically talks about, you can give the example of BBIN. Now Bhutan is not part of it. Grid connectivity, Blue Economy initiatives are the examples you're talking about. Its priority areas where it is focusing on. But when it is asking about evaluation, you have to talk about what are its strengths and weakness. It is an alternative, a strong alternative to BIMSTEC, but it does not, it has its own problems. What are the problems? FTA has not been enforced till date. All the countries except India have very low purchasing power. So there is low, I mean, when you have some countries are at higher levels of income and other countries are at lower levels of income, it creates, there is no complementarity among the countries with respect to economic integration. Lack of connectivity. Connectivity is the biggest issue. Lack of connectivity is the biggest issue among. There is no single window facility for everything, maybe for credit or maybe for developmental partnership, etc. And more importantly, this entire institution is being run by one country, that is India. India contributes about 31% of the budget. So this is a general idea that if any organization is single-handedly funded by one country or predominantly funded by one country, there is a likeliness that this organization may not survive over a period, because regional organizations survive under the principles of pluralism and not single country dominance. So these are the points you are answering with respect to BIMSTEC. So where are you getting more marks in this particular answer? So first thing is, also you can talk about, when you're talking about the observations which I'm making with respect to this question is, first thing, it was a current event. BIMSTEC summit was recently held in Kathmandu only, and taking a cue from this, that was asked. So you could, in the first introduction only, you could also give, in 2018 the summit was held in Kathmandu. So this is one point, will get you more marks. So SAARC is in a limbo. These are the two major events which have led to the question BIMSTEC. Since R was not working, BIMSTEC summits were happening. The question is asked, how are you getting more marks? In what context you are getting more marks? First is, if you are sticking to the question, if you are sticking only to the technical and economic cooperation and evaluation, if you have given very specific points and theoretical integration. So when the question is being asked related to something called technical and economic, when the examiner is so specific with respect to what he is asking, he expects you that you write a theory called functionalism, because functionalism is the only theory under liberalism which talks about this kind of cooperation. Moving to the next question, do you think sustainable development goals are really attainable? This question which has been asked from contemporary global concerns environment. Now I'll be making an observation at the end that many questions have been asked under contemporary global concerns, why and all that we'll discuss. So in this, so this is again very particular question. One more trend in almost all the question papers this year, last year and the year previous to it, questions are being very particular. Specific factual details or factual questions are being asked. So what does this ensure? What does this teach us as a lesson that we'll be discussing at the end? So what does it say? Are they achievable is what it is trying to ask, attainable by 2030. So first is part one, talk about, introduce SDG. What are sustainable development goals? These are the goals or targets which replace millennium development goals. So these were agreed to in 2015. They are different from millennium development goals in a specific aspect. These are based on bottom-up approach. These are not based on top-down approach. MDGs are top-down targets where UN makes those targets and gives it to the different countries, whereas SDGs are based on bottom approach. This is very specific. This is very important. You have to write in Paul Science, because Paul Science, or the subject here which they are asking, is environmental governance. It is not just environment like GS environment. It is governance aspect. So that governance aspect, what is the governance framework, what it is trying to achieve through SDGs, is what you have to write. So it has 17 goals, 169 targets. The aim of these, the target year is 2030. So it has different it talks about varied things. You can just give general ideas regarding poverty, hunger, infrastructure, ocean development, environmental protection, environmental conservation. Give that introduction in part one. Part two, achievability debate. This question was asked because there was an annual checkup report. So you give certain factual details to prove how much we have achieved. So maternal mortality rate, how much we have reduced. So these factual details have outlined. Give some factual details where you prove that, okay, certain developments have been made and certain developments are yet to be made, is what you're trying to say. So unsafe drinking water, sanitation continues to be the reason for mortality. Poverty affected by disasters and climate change still remains a major problem, though other things have been controlled to certain extent, it was the same. Now part three is the most important part. Now when you say that we may not achieve all those things, but still there is a use value of this. What is the use value? Sustainable development goals are meant to make institutions. So when you look at sustainable development, why do you require all this when you are not necessarily achieving it? First is, you require a goal to achieve those targets. If you do not have a goal, international organizations or countries will not work for sustainable development. That is one thing. Second thing is, all common property resources, maybe environment, maybe economic resources, global commons, they have a problem of tragedy of commons. Give the theory of Garrett Hardin. Tragedy of commons is what? A common property is no one's property, no one takes the responsibility. So if we do not have certain institutions and agreements, these will be exploited. So in that case, SDGs are required. So it addresses the issue of tragedy of commons, is what you're trying to say. Third is, SDGs are more important for developing countries. There is always a divide between the north and the south, what we call as the developed and the developing countries. Developed countries are more economically well off and they are not much worried about the poverty and hunger in the developing countries. So in order to make them responsible also under the banner of UN, SDGs are required. So these are the points you are writing with respect to the need for sustainable development goals. Now how do you get more marks under this? So one is the theoretical integration which you are making time and again, sustainable development, what kind of governance it is, tragedy of global commons, you're getting more marks when you're giving some facts here and there as to you're proving why you're proving why it is being achieved, or how much of it is being achieved, or why it is and why it is not achievable completely by 2030. Those certain factual details, if you give, will be getting more marks. Now, one observation I would like to make here: global issues question, which has been asked as environment question. Many people have a tendency to go to very minute issues of environment. They'll be studying all important acts, etc., and all for politics. But remember, in political science, environment, though has been explicitly mentioned in your syllabus, you should not be going to Indian-related questions. It is global. When we say global, all global developments that have occurred, Paris Pact, SDGs, etc., those questions will be more as global developments is what you're looking at. And more importantly, you are looking at global governance, not the science of environment. And more importantly, one more thing which you have to remember is, with respect to all these issues, like global issues, environment, etc., current developments become very important. More of this I'll be speaking at the end when I make observations on the entire paper. Next is examine. So now we are coming to the 10 markers are done. Now we are coming to 20 and 15 mark questions. So first is examine the significance of comparative method in political analysis. Discuss its limitations. So there are two parts to this question. First is significance of comparative politics. The subject is comparative politics. The keyword is significance and limitations. So these are the two issues you should be addressing. Where it is, which part of the syllabus it is. Part A, comparative politics. Nature is what it is being asked. So it is asking about comparative politics itself. It is not asking about some specific approach. So generally about comparative politics. So first is define comparative. Part one, you'll be discussing what is comparative politics, its definition, origin, evolution and methods. So when you talk about comparative politics refers to what comparison of two different constitutions or political institutions or any kind of political variable. So what is a political variable? Voting behavior in two different countries elections in two different countries. So all those are political variables. Caste system in two different countries, caste influence and voting behavior in two different countries. So it could be a comparison of constitutions, or it could be a comparison of political system in total. It could be a comparison of political variables, particular variables. So comparative politics, though a modern discipline, it had its origin in ancient Greece with Aristotle taking up this particular method, wherein he is considered as the father of comparative politics, because he's the first person to study 158 constitutions, make a comparison of them, and then bring a comparative political systems, good and the bad political systems, which he talks about. So he becomes the father of comparative politics. In comparative politics, what is the method which is being used? That you have to explain. What is the method which is being used? It is called the inductive method is what you are observing facts, then you are making a generalization. This is what is done in comparative method. You compare and then draw certain inferences. So deductive method is followed by Plato. Aristotle follows is what what he follows is inductive method, and that forms the basis of comparative method. So comparative method has two phases, phase one and phase two. Phase one is prior to World War II. Phase two is after World War II. After World War II, comparative method or comparative politics starts acquiring behavioral aspects, science aspects, and it becomes more and more scientific. So these are the types you are talking about. Give certain examples: political economy approach, political sociology approach. So in part one, you are giving complete idea about comparative method, because it's a 20 mark question. You cannot just jump to significance and limitations. Give an in-depth thing: definition, origin, evolution and methods is the examples which I have given. Now significance is about this. So what does it help in doing? It helps in comparing things. So in your syllabus, comparative politics has been mentioned. They have asked you to compare states, they have asked you to compare political participation, maybe political parties, social movements, etc. So you can compare with comparative methods. You can compare states, you can compare constitutions, you can compare other political variables like NGOs, functioning of NGOs, social movements in developed and developing countries. So this helps in comparing different countries is one explanation. Second is one advantage, the interdisciplinary. What is interdisciplinary? So when you are trying to compare, you are bringing different knowledge of different different disciplines into it. So for example, political economy approach is an interdisciplinary approach. It is bringing economic aspects into politics. So this makes political science interdisciplinary. It expands the horizons of political science. It makes political science a dynamic subject is what you're writing. Third is second phase of which I discussed in evolution. Second phase of comparative politics brings scientific developments and it brings new analytical frameworks. What are the new analytical frameworks? Communications approach, systems approach, structural functionals approach, decision making, games theory are all part of the comparative developments only. So they bring scientific developments and new analytical frameworks. They help in analyzing how communication plays a role. What is political socialization? What is political acculturization, etc. Next is talk about some specific methods and their importance. What is the importance of political economy? Political economy for the first time brings an economic focus to politics. That is, what is the role of state in economy? Your aspects, for example, in green revolution in India, LPG reforms in India, they can be studied better only through political economy approach. What was the role of state in green revolution? What is the role of state in LPG reforms? How was the role of state changed prior to and after 1991? So all these are developments of comparative method. How Indian state of India in the field of economy, and state of US in the field of economy, and state of China in the field of economy, they can all be compared. Political sociology is bringing society factors or societal factors into analysis, like caste, religion, politics, caste, religion, class, etc. So comparison of class factor in India and China, how they influence state, etc. So all these are possible with this. So you are getting good marks once you are giving example for every kind of point you are making. So don't just write jargons after jargons. Make it simple. Make it explain it in your own way and give examples to prove your point. Now, what are the limitations? Limitations first is, when you look at comparative politics evolution, most of them emerge in the Western countries. When they emerge in the Western countries, comparison was not completely objective. So they were bringing certain standards of the West and then comparing with the East or the developing countries. So developing countries did not have their own models till very recently. It is only in the second phase that the developing countries get their own model for comparative analysis. So there is a domination of one specific ideology called the liberal ideology. Western model is many times being considered as a standard. I'll give an example of this. When India is compared, Indian federal model is compared with the Western federal model, US federal model. And India's federalism model is described as quasi-federal. But this is incorrect, because when you're saying India is quasi-federal, you're comparing with US, because and you're assuming that US is a perfect model. US in itself is not a perfect model. It has changed dramatically. It is not so federal as it was earlier after the economic depression. So such comparison, such models are actually not neutral. They reek of bias. So it does not give you a neutral framework. Many a times, these models which have emerged under comparative politics came as a defense of capitalism in the West. So they are criticized as status quo models. They don't want any kind of change because they are focusing only on the scientific aspects. They are collecting data. They are making certain observations. They are not wanting any kind of change or they're not prescribing any change. And more importantly, I've said to you, it is not just the ideological bias, subjective bias of a person who is involved in the practical operation of comparative politics. There it is difficult to evict bias. So if I'm making comparative analysis, I am situated in a particular place, in a particular time framework. So when I'm situated in that space and time framework, it is very difficult to move out of that framework. And hence, personal bias will always come. And due to impact on behavioralism, it became very scientific, and the same idea, it became status quo. So models, their values were completely neglected. Sometimes it so happens that there are certain practical problems in comparison. You don't get a data related to a particular country. For example, African countries, collection of statistics in itself is very less. So comparison becomes difficult. And you can compare only when two countries are similar and different in certain aspects. So drastically similar countries cannot be compared. For example, all capitalist societies, US and South Korea suppose, similarities are so huge that comparison on comparative politics does not have much to contribute. So if the countries are completely different, US and suppose there is a dictator North Korea, they're completely different in terms of political system. So comparison or comparative, when you do a comparison, you have certain similarities, you have certain differences. So comparative model does not work in these two situations. If they are drastically similar, if they're completely different, it is not possible to compare them. So these are the drawbacks you're writing. Part four, what you're trying to explain is, at the end in your concluding, you are talking about how it was a, though it has its own drawbacks, it was a big development in political science. It brought an interdisciplinary scientific approach or scientific methodology to political science is what you're trying to, is what you say and conclude. Next is, okay, now, how are you getting more marks and what are the observations on this? See, one observation I'm going to make once I do the low voter turnout question regarding comparative politics and how the number of questions is increasing. Now, also one more thing which you have to remember with respect to last question is, your idea should be comparative politics in general. Don't take up one model and write advantages and drawbacks of that particular model in a comparative politics. Use them very wisely. The analysis should be very broader in when you're writing an answer. Next is, explain the reasons for lower voter turnout in democratic countries with suitable examples. So where do you place this? This is part of comparative politics only. Under comparative politics, there is a section, politics of representation and participation. So it is the idea of participation which is being, so voting is a kind of participation. So democratic countries, how, what are the reasons it is asking? So reasons you have to explain with certain suitable examples. Now my observation in this is, give both developed and developing countries examples so that you fetch more marks. So in this, as it is a part A question, give certain theory to explain this participation. Whenever you talk about participation, there is one standard theory you can always use, given by Gabriel Armand and Sidney Verba in his book Civic Culture, where he talks about three different kinds of individuals in a country, in a democratic culture. First is subjects, parochials, third is participants. So subjects are those, parochial, subjects, and participants are three different kind of individuals. So parochials are those people who are not concerned with any kind of state activity. They are completely apathetic towards state. Subjects are those who only want from state, they don't contribute to the state. Participants, they demand from the state and they also contribute by political participation. So this framework gives you the idea of political participation, the theory behind political participation. You can use this in answering those questions. So first you give the theory and talk about the idea of political culture. Political culture reflects in different ways, that is voter participation. It is also in contesting elections, criticisms against the government. So there are many factors involved in building a political culture. Those are the reasons responsible for voter participation as well. So with this theory you start, and then you could move to part two. What are the reasons for low voter participation? The first reason is, talk about parochials and subjects. So here I'm basically focusing on the developing countries more. Developed countries I'll come to later. So there are, in developing countries, you mostly have parochials, you mostly have subjects. So parochials are those who are not concerned or completely immune to the state activity. They are apathetic to the state activity. In that case, what happens is, developing countries have more parochials. What does this mean? Political culture is weak in such countries. So subjects there, are the individuals there, are not concerned enough about their role as a citizen. So lack of political culture and political literacy is what I'm speaking about. That was one of the reasons for lower voter turnout. So if political culture is not strong, then voter participation will be less. Second is feeling of not able to make an impact. So many subjects or many individuals in a country, in a developing country, they feel that their participation in the voting does not necessarily lead to a big change because they are one small individual in a large democracy, in a large population. So this is a, there is a specific theory involved in this. This is a contradiction between liberalism and democracy. Liberalism does not always go with democracy. Liberalism says what? Every individual is has a right of his own, every individual has a personality of his own. But liberalism did not get its own kind of democracy, it didn't get an ideal political system, hence it adopts democracy. Democracy is a kind of, for them it is a kind of compromise which they have made, because it is the only feasible political system existing today. But in a large democracy, what happens is many individuals feel that they are not able to make an impact, that is why they don't participate in the voting. And third is hopelessness among subjects. With respect to developing countries, there is a hopelessness that state, despite repeated participation by the subjects or individuals in elections, no government has been able to deliver what they demand. When I say deliver what they are demanding, demands refer to the old issues, meaning your economic livelihood, your day-to-day economic activities, your basic issues like poverty, standard of living, hunger, etc. All these issues are not addressed. Hence, it brings a kind of hopelessness among the people. So these are the issues which matter in a developing country. There are certain issues which matter in a developed country. What are those? First is political apathy. So in developed countries, the issues are slightly different. Many states or many individuals have not been participating, or there is no huge participation in recent time in developed countries, in Western countries, particularly because there is a political apathy among the individuals. The reason for that apathy is different. The issues now for them is not the old issues like livelihood, etc. They have moved beyond the old issues called the new issues. So this these new issues are what? Environmental issues, or political, or animal rights, or even environmental issues, democracy, human rights. So all these are new issues. These new issues are not being addressed by the state. So they are now moving to new kinds of institutions to get these issues addressed. For example, NGOs have become more active. So when individuals are getting more options with respect to state, with respect to the institutions which can satisfy their demands in the form of NGOs, etc., their participation in the state has become lesser. Next is this is with respect to the developing country, particularly India. This is with respect to those people. These are the people who are demanding new issues in developing countries itself. So suppose I, as a person, I am happy with the economic development, etc., in our country, and I'm demanding new issues, environmental rights, etc., and all, and I'm unhappy with the entire political spectrum. I don't like any of the parties, and I still want to participate. So in that case, NOTA helps. But NOTA has also been found ineffective because this has not materialized into participation of the people. Earlier, people would not participate because there was no negative voting. But even with NOTA, people are not participating because NOTA does not necessarily realize into the expectations of the negative voter. It does not make any change in the political system. This has been one more reason in the developing countries, particularly India. Next is low voter turnout is also because of the logistical issues. This may emerge from the demand that the clause or the caveat or the condition that an individual should be present at the polling booth to cast his vote. In that case, physical problems, infrastructural, logistical issues play a key role. If someone is in a different state and if you don't give him postal ballot, etc., this could lead to an issue. If someone is residing outside, NRIs, though they have the vote, right to vote, they have to be physically present. This also creates a hurdle. These are logistical issues which also lead to the lesser voter participation. Next is frequent elections. India is known for this phenomenon. Frequent elections also lead to what? It induces a certain kind of electoral fatigue. People are fed up because it stops the entire normal functioning of the society. People have to take the day off from their work. It is a loss on their wages, etc. So that also leads to a kind of lesser participation. Next is, one theory has been given by Richard Sklow. He says that recent technological developments, particularly the IT, wherein the virtual world has grown more important, direct participation of the people has reduced. All social life has become virtual. All social activities have become virtual. Real social activities, real political activities have reduced. Hence, technology has also been responsible for lesser democratic participation, is what he says. Now, part three, what you're writing is, when you talked about the reasons, you have to give certain solutions also. The solution is basically political socialization. What is political socialization? If you actually have to make a system democratic, you should follow the principle of participatory democracy. Participatory democracy given by Gandhi, participatory democracy given by C.B. Macpherson, where strong political cultural culture is built. This is through political socialization. You socialize people. That starts from school days only, wherein civics or political aspects or political structure of India or political civics aspects of India and building of citizenship becomes a fundamental duty in this fundamental idea in the schools itself. This is how it can be tackled and effective participation can be ensured. So what are the observations with respect to the last two questions? First thing which you have to notice is comparative politics is being explored a lot. Now, this is not a trend of this year. Last year also many comparative politics questions have been asked. Now, what has been happening? Approaches question. So usually what is the thought process of UPSC? UPSC does not ask those questions which are excessively explored, which are in the limelight, which are into the face. So what does it do? It will look in those gray areas or look into those gray areas where an aspirant does not focus. This is one gray area, comparative politics, because first there is a dearth of standard material on this, but many questions are being asked and approaches question have in fact reduced. There was only one approach question, that is Marxist approach. And that too in case of options, and it was an optional question. You could also, I mean, many had the choice to leave that question as well. So it has the importance of that approaches has reduced to such lows that it has become difficult to solve the entire paper, because comparative politics is one area where you students usually don't focus on, and when they don't have an academic material on that, they'll start writing general answers. So how do you address this issue? That I'll be discussing in the end. And also you'll get more marks when you focus on developed and developing countries. It's a comparative politics question. When it is saying democratic countries, it has not specified developed democratic countries or developing democratic countries. So give examples of both. And theoretical framework is very, very important. It is always necessary. It is always important to link part A with part B, part B with part A. And since it is in part A, theoretical aspects have to be explained. Political socialization is theoretical aspect. Political culture is a theoretical aspect. Civic culture is political. Civic culture is the theoretical aspect. So all those keywords here and there will fetch you a lot of marks. Next is evaluate the role of International Court of Justice in interstate disputes. So this is a question where it is, let us identify the key terms, role it is asking, evaluation in a specific area, interstate disputes. Where do you place this? We have already discussed the syllabus. UN it is asking, and that is specifically a specialized, envisage role and actual record. It is under this. So under this, entire under structure of UN, you have organs of UN. Under organs of UN, one has been asked. So this was in news a lot, that is why this has been asked. Now what are the parts you're writing? Part one, introduce ICJ. When you're introducing ICJ, what are the important points you're writing? ICJ is one of the organs of UN. It is a adjudicatory organ. It adjudicates on interstate disputes. States are parties to it. So it performs the function of maintaining international peace and security under UN Charter, Article 50. So when it is, so this is the idea you're mentioning. But more importantly, you have to also give the historical aspects of it. It replaces the earlier Permanent Court of International Justice, which was established under League of Nations. Talk about its composition also. It is composed of 15 judges. Every judge is elected, nominated, and then elected for a period of 9 years. So these are the points you're writing. It forms so all cases are heard by the complete full court, and the bench which is hearing the full court is presided by one of the judges who is elected by the other judges. One among them is elected the president. So this is the introduction you're giving. So when you're giving this introduction, I'm very precise. I'm not talking about general ideas like ICJ is this, etc. I'm giving very specific points. I'm talking about 9 years, 15 judges, etc. So this gives an impression that you know ICJ perfectly. So such points are important to prove that you have read the topic, in fact. And since this is a theory part question, talk about theories also. Which are the theories you can apply here? The first person to talk about an international organization is in terms of UN and all was specific UN by Kant. But more than that theory, for me, the relevant theory under this is Bentham's theory. It is Bentham who says that there should be an international tribunal for solving of disputes, interstate disputes, and to maintain international peace and security. So you can give this one theory. So ICJ is based on this theory of Bentham. And ICJ is also based on the international law principle given by Hugo Grotius. So these are the two theories you can speak about, two thinkers you should speak about. Next is, it is asking about interstate disputes, its jurisdiction, evaluate it. So first talk about what are the powers it has in part two about the in solving the interstate dispute. Basically, there are two kinds of powers it has, contentious powers and advisory powers. So when you look at the words, what does it exactly? Contentious is one where the advice is binding. Advisory is one where the judgment is not binding. So this is the basic difference. Now under contentious, what happens? There are two types, compulsory and voluntary. Compulsory means what? Compulsory is compulsory are those issues where it is only ICJ that has the authority to adjudicate on those issues. How does this function? In certain treaties, it is very clearly written that if there is a conflict related to that treaty, this treaty will be adjudicated or the issue will be adjudicated by ICJ. ICJ has the exclusive right to adjudicate. So this is compulsory. So it is written in the treaty itself. For example, UNCLOS, under that it is clearly written. For example, Vienna Convention on Consular Relation, which came under Kulbhushan Jadhav case, in case any conflict occurs between the two countries on this issue, it is ICJ which has the power. So it is compulsory. Parties do not have any independence under this. Next is voluntary. Now under voluntary, this is when both the parties have agreed to voluntarily come to ICJ to take that issue. So compulsory issue, I have given an example of this. Voluntary issue, you can give the example of India-Pakistan Kulbhushan Jadhav issue, wherein India filed a complaint, Pakistan also accepted, and Pakistan didn't have a judge of its own, so there was an ad hoc judge which was appointed. This is voluntary jurisdiction. But in both these cases, once the judgment is given, it is binding. It is not binding in certain cases. What are those that we'll discuss? But generally, it is binding. What is advisory jurisdiction? Advisory jurisdiction where jurisdiction over it, but still when the issue is brought to it, ICJ adjudicates on it, but the adjudication or the judgment given is not binding, it is just advisory. So best example of this is recently the Chagos Archipelago issue was taken to ICJ. ICJ had no exclusive jurisdiction on that, but ICJ still makes a judgment. The judgment wherein it said that UK should give the archipelago back to Mauritius, this is not binding in nature, it is just advisory in nature. So these are the examples you are giving. This is very, very important. Without this basis, your evaluation analysis becomes, it is useless, because this will show that you know only the analysis, you don't know what exactly is ICJ. Next is part three, evaluate. So ICJ has played a role in adjudication of disputes through examples I've explained. For example, Kulbhushan Jadhav, it helped India. For example, in Diego Garcia, it brings a moral standing, it gives a moral standing to those. But there are certain problems in the functioning of ICJ, the negative aspect of it. So what is the negative aspect? First is, even after ICJ decision is given, it can be vetoed. So once it is, the judgment is given, it is bound to be implemented. But if it is brought to UNSC and then one of the members vetoes it, the decision is nullified. So legal issues can get politicized, and the powers of the dominant countries may prevail. And many times it has happened also. For example, US had a conflict with Nicaragua, and US is a party to this ICJ, and hence when ICJ adjudicated in favor of Nicaragua Islands, what did UN US do? US did not implement that decision. US took the decision to United Nations Security Council. It was taken to UNSC. US vetoed that particular decision. So, despite being compulsory, it is not compulsory because it was under a specific treaty, the entire issue. Despite being compulsory, the issue was still vetoed. So, this is related to this. So, voluntary clause in compulsory. What does it mean? It says that even if a treaty is says that ICJ has the adjudication power, when the judgment is given, it is not binding on the parties. The parties can actually say that, okay, I'm not under this treaty, I'm not going to follow it. So this is one big problem. This is one voluntary clause, and also the other issue is linked with this. Any particular decision taken can be vetoed in United Nations Security Council. Third thing is ICJ has implementation issues. That is, it does not have a separate authority for itself to implement. So when the implementation comes under UNSC itself, there could be a conflict of interest. If the parties involved in the case are one of the members of UNSC, no country will be implementing it, or that country will not be implementing it precisely because there is a conflict of interest involved. The other problem is certain issues are voluntary in nature, which I said. I mean, certain parties would not want to come to ICJ despite involved in severe violations of the treaty. For example, Pakistan itself was involved in severe violation. So many a times it may so happen that ICJ may not be able to adjudicate. In that case, what happens? It is short of that international governance ideal which we are trying to achieve. And also these are related to the problems related to its decision and implementation. There is a problem related to the election of judges also. Election of judges, how it is held, a judge is deemed to be elected if he is elected by absolute majority in both Security Council and General Assembly. So since it is both Security Council and General Assembly, a developing country is, it is not favorable towards a developing country, that we have seen in Dalveer Bhandari case. So Security Council did not elect Dalveer Bhandari, it elected the candidate of UK, but in case of General Assembly, it elected Dalveer Bhandari. So this also creates election has a bias towards the developed countries because SC Security Council is involved. So five countries are exercising their clout over that big General Assembly of around 190 countries. So this is one problem. Next is bias of judges. Bias of judges is, though there is a neutral or impartial method that PCA nominates and sends to Permanent Court of Arbitration, sends the judges to nominated judges, and then election happens. Judges are national judges. They have come from a specific country. So many a times it has been seen that bias does not completely go away from, it is difficult to evict bias from judges. So these are the problems with ICJ. So at the end, what you are trying to talk about is UNSC reforms. Conclusion, what you are giving is UNSC reforms will be the most important development, and changing all this, implementation authority, voluntary issue, all these changes would take ICJ far, is what you are concluding. Now, how do you get more marks in this? And current examples is what, since it's a current issue, current examples will highly matter. For example, Diogo Garcia Isha, that is the Diogo Garcia is the Chagos archipelago. Then you have Kulbushan Jadhav case, etc. Such examples will bring you a lot of marks, and more importantly, theory like Jeremy Bentham theory, etc., that you can discuss. And when you're discussing the criticism is what, US dominance or dominance of certain countries in ICJ also. So dominance of one country clearly shows that UN is not a multilateral institution, it is nothing but a domination of nation state itself, hence realism applies there. So they're there in criticisms. When you're giving, you can use realist theory also to explain that how it is not purely liberal, it is realist ideas are applicable in UN as well, is what you're trying to explain. Now, these are the points with respect to the second question. Moving to the third question under this, first is explain the relevance of Marxist approach in the context of globalization. This is the only question which you have an approach, and that too Marxist, because 200 years of his celebration of Marx, birth of Marx were held in 2018. 1818 was his birth year. So two questions were asked related to Marx. One was this in IR, and there was one question in political theory also, relevance of Marx, Marx's ideas. So both were relevance. It is relevance precisely because after 200 years of birth, how much of his theories are relevant. So this is also current inspired, is what I'm trying to communicate to you. So where do you place it in syllabus? It is in approaches. So Marx's approach. Now what it is asking, it is asking relevance in the context of globalization. So in the context of globalization, what is the relevance of Marxism? First is explain Marx's approach. What exactly does it say? So Marx's approach very specifically talk about its take on globalization. So part one, wherein part one talk about thinkers like Marx, Lenin and Nkrumah, who are all part of that Marxist framework, but they do not specifically talk about globalization, they hint about globalization. So Marx talks about crisis in capitalism, Lenin talks about imperialism as the highest stage of capitalism, Nkrumah talks about neo-colonialism, but specifically they don't talk about globalization, they give a foundation to globalization. So Lenin's idea of imperialism is nothing but a form of globalization only, but exclusive globalization theories emerge later, that is under Wallerstein, then Robert Cox. Robert Cox is more important. Wallerstein, you know, explain about the world systems theory and how center, periphery and semi-peripheral relations are coordinated in an exploitative framework, that you have to explain. Robert Cox talks about social structures. He says that globalization provides a momentum. US-led globalization has provided a momentum for exploitation, which Wallerstein does not exclusively focus on. So it is actually Robert Cox who applies Gramscian approach and talks about globalization particularly. Now after this, there is one more person, Andrew Linklater, who also talks about globalization. Then you can also talk about Benotech, who also speak about globalization. So these are the thinkers you are talking about globalization. So basically, overall, these are the schools. So first generation thinkers. After this, you have the second generation thinkers. Robert Cox specifically talks about them. Thereafter, it is critical school and new Marxism. Critical school is Andrew Linklater and Benotech is new Marxism. So all these people talk about globalization. What is their major idea? They say globalization is uneven. Globalization is exploitative. Bretton Woods institutions are pro these developing countries. So what are the just give a fair idea of which are the thinkers and who talk about globalization. After that, talk about the relevance. In relevance, you have to be very, very particular about what thoughts or ideas of Marxist approach are relevant today. First idea which is relevant today about Marx is, or in the context of globalization, is Marx and crisis. Marx was the first person to talk about crisis in capitalism, where it's here he says that capitalism will dig its own grave. This idea of crisis finds a reflection of it in the international arena. So we have seen many crises under capitalism, maybe economic depression or 1997 crisis or 2008 global financial crisis. So Marx was the first person to talk about such crises, though may not be completely apt. His theory is not completely that crisis which he talks about, but he was the first person to talk about crisis. So that is one relevance we can discuss. Second is institutionalized exploitation. Globalization today is uneven. It is not true cosmopolitanism. Certain developed countries are gaining at the cost of the developing countries. So Marx's approach, that is Wallerstein's approach and also Robert Cox's approach, was the first new framework or alternative framework for international relations. Till then, international relations was mainly dominated by liberalism and realism. So liberalism said globalization is fine, integration is good for everyone. Realism says globalization will never occur. Even if it occurs, it will be at the demands of nation state. So there was no alternative perspective till then. So Marxism, that is this theory, Wallerstein's theory, first provides a challenge to these theories. It says that globalization is an extension of nation state, as what realists say, but realists, they celebrate this, whereas Marxists criticize this. So first alternative perspective under them, and it is the first scientific perspective as well. Till then, liberalism and realists were more normative theories until neoliberalism and neo-realists come, but it is Marxism which brings a scientific approach. So when you look at the entire systems theory, wherein Immanuel Wallerstein's systems theory, wherein he talks about periphery, center and the semi-periphery. It is an application of systems theory, that is systems approach given by David Easton to Marxism. So this is bringing scientific principles also. So in a sense, it is even relevant today. The scientific approach is what Marx has contributed, or Marxist approach has contributed. Now, globalization was uneven is what I said. So this is the first theory which talks about the North-South divide, the politics of the developed and the developing countries. So this brings a new framework, that is NIEO, etc., and all are all somewhere influenced by the Marxist ideas. Next is, it gives a new bend, new attitude to analyze to the MNCs. MNCs are more favorable to the developed countries is what Marxist approach for the first time speaks about. That is one contribution, and which is true today also. Most of the MNCs are dominating are in the developed or concentrated in the developed countries, and they exercise a huge clout on the nation state. They in fact control many decisions of the nation state today. Next is a rift in the third world grouping and emerging countries as a buffer. This is one more explanation which Marxism gives. If you look at the systems theory, semi-peripheral states are, these are new emerging countries, these are new capitalist states which are emerging. Under this framework come the examples like India, China, etc. So what has happened, earlier there was just developed and developing countries, now it has happened what? Developed, emerging, developing countries. So earlier developing countries are one group, there was a unity among them. With the emerging countries, there is a rift which has occurred, and more countries are moving towards that capitalism, and globalization is propagating. So semi-peripheral was a new phenomenon expressed by Marxism. So it offers a sufficient explanation for emerging states like East, Southeast Asian states, tiger economies, China, India, etc. And more importantly, this is the only theory which gave an alternative perspective on Bretton Woods. Bretton Woods, if you look at, when you analyze, Bretton Woods was established at, it was a handiwork of UN in 1944. When it did not work in the favor of US, US withdraw, it collapsed, withdrew, it collapsed, and in 1970, US again established Bretton Woods phase to Washington consensus. So it was Marxist framework which gave the first analysis about Bretton Woods as not an international institution, not a plurilateral institution, but an institution which works in the favor of US. And more importantly, globalization faced many challenges due to its non-cosmopolitan nature. Many, for example, World Social Forum was established. So global civil society movement emerged, anti-globalization movements emerged. This was, can be sufficiently explained by Marxist framework. Marxism talks about challenges to, or movements as challenges to, capitalism and globalism. So Marxism offers explanation to all of this, and hence it is relevant today in the event of globalization. But it is not completely relevant, it is outdated or outmoded also in certain case. What are the things it cannot explain? It cannot explain capitalism is not digging its own grave. Globalization is expanding over a period, it is not crumbling. That is where Marxism has failed. Ever expanding global middle class, in as part of globalization, Marxism cannot explain. What Marxism had said, that there will be a proletariat, or the proletarian revolution will occur, proletariat class will emerge, that has not happened. Globalization is not all exploitative. It has led to the development of certain countries. For example, emerging countries in the south, that is tiger economies, India, China, have accrued benefits of globalization. So that is where it becomes faulty. Bretton Woods is not all parochial. Bretton Woods also has functioned in the favor of certain countries. Bretton Woods reforms have occurred, quota reforms have occurred, G20 has been established. So Marx cannot explain them, because we have got all this without a revolution. No international proletarism, we have already discussed. Marxism cannot explain new issues. Marxism approach to globalization mainly focuses on those aspects of economy. It does not focus on environmental aspects, it does not focus on democracy, nuclear proliferation, etc. So new issues of globalization which have emerged, maybe terrorism, maybe global civil society, etc. Marxism does not offer a sufficient explanation, because Marxism focuses only on the economic aspects. Marxism does not focus on cultural factors also. Today there are many effects of globalization. For example, one of the effects of globalization is clash of civilization. Civilizational conflict between the West and the East, civilization conflict between the West and West Asia, US and West Asia in the form of terrorism. All this could not be explained by Marxism. It could be more explained by the framework given by Samuel Huntington, that is clash of civilization. This is where Marxism has failed. So at the end, what you're trying to conclude is, despite its own limitations, it was a breakthrough, or it was a fundamental break in terms of as an approach, because it gave a completely new framework of analysis vis-a-vis liberalism and realism, is what you're trying to conclude. Now, what are the observations with respect to the question? First is, it is a current issue, I mentioned, 200 years of after the birth of Marx, reduced, then the number of questions have reduced. So in this, you'll be getting more marks, where if you are showing a strong proof in theory, talk about those theories which specifically talk about globalization. Don't generally talk about Marxist approach. Marx or Marxist take on globalization is what you're speaking about. So your points have to be very particular, what it can explain, what it cannot explain. Next is, identify the benefits of multipolar world. This has been a very surprising development for me in this paper. It is now focusing on a purely theoretical question, and that too a question which was never expected. See, this if you see world orders, it is not it is not mentioned very overtly in the syllabus. Whenever you look at the syllabus, what you see is, you see a main term, changing international political order or international economic order, economic system, or international political economy is what you see, and then you see subtopics under that. So what you generally do is, you focus on the subtopics, you don't focus on this. For example, when you talk about regionalization, your focus is not in regionalization, your focus is on ASEAN, BIMS, APEC, etc. and all. So what this time the surprising development is, this particular heading itself is picked up and is being asked as a question. So it won't be an amazing or a surprising thing in case UPSC is going to ask questions like phases of regionalization, or contemporary global concerns, if that was a big question in the upcoming years. So this is one development. It is asking about the world order only. So world structure. So in your world structure, world order, what is prescribed? Your historical aspects are prescribed from 1945 to all the developments have been prescribed. So Cold War, post-Cold War, US hegemony, and multipolar world. These are the three world orders which have been prescribed. So one world order has been asked, that is the present world order has been asked, and that too theory question. They're not asking you what are the new developments as part of multipolar world today. It is asking benefits of multipolar world. The first person to talk about world orders is Kenneth Waltz as a realist. So it is directly from his theory which has been picked. He speaks about, he compares the world orders, the multipolar world order, unipolar, and also bipolar world order, and he comes to the conclusion that the bipolar world order is the most stable system. So keep this in mind. This is two questions have been asked with respect to world order. What is India's vision of the world order? Second is benefits of multiple world order. Okay, now syllabus we have identified. What are the answer, how are you answering? In answer, in part one, you are discussing the theoretical aspects of the world order. What do you understand by a world order? World order refers to the distribution of power. World order, when you define something as this is a world order, you are talking about distribution of power in that system. Which country has what power, which country has lesser power, etc. and all. So world order gives you a fair idea of how the distribution of authority has occurred, the distribution of power. World order also talks about the stability in that system. So depending on the configurations of power, what it will lead to? It could lead to the configuration of cooperation and conflict. How much cooperation is possible and how much conflict is possible, due to which stability can be assessed. So this is the definition of a world order. World order gives you two ideas: stability about that system, it gives a knowledge about the stability of the system, it also gives the configuration of that power. For example, bipolar world order, according to Kenneth Waltz, is what it there the power is distributed in two countries, two blocks, and it is the most stable system in his opinion. So when you say bipolar world order, it is giving you two ideas: distribution of power and how stable it is. So give this definition and talk about Kenneth Waltz being the first person who talks about world order, and depending on this you can analyze the benefits of a multipolar world. So what are the benefits of a multipolar world? So benefits of a multipolar world is what? Multipolar world is supported by liberals, and hence they are indirectly asking you the what is the liberal take on multipolar world order. So liberals believe in or support multipolar world order. They believe that it is the most ideal world order, wherein they call it the no polar world order. What is no polar world order? States and along with states, NGOs are coexisting, non-state actors are coexisting for a better plural world order. Now, what are the benefits liberalism speaks about? Now, what you have to say is benefits of a multipolar world order depend on the composition. So how it is composed or what are the constituent elements of that multipolar world order, depending on that, the benefits also change. So if you see, you have seen two kinds of multipolar world order till date. One is multipolar world order of the yesteryear, that is during the BOP mechanism. So BOP mechanism after 1648, Treaty of Westphalia, in the European region, multipolar world order comes into existence. So that you can look at that and explain what are the advantages. Today also there is an emerging multipolar world order. It is said that US is no longer the dominant power. Many new countries are emerging. China is there, India is there, southern countries like Brazil, South Africa, Russian re-emergence is leading to a multipolar world order. So looking at this, these are two different types. Depending on their types, advantages also change. So what are the advantages? When you look at the world order which existed, multipolar world order during that period, it brought a sense of stability. Though there were wars, but the some kind of BOP mechanism existed. So it brought a certain kind of stability. That was one advantage. If you look at multipolar world order today, what could be the advantage? First, it will change how institutions function in total. When I talk about institution, it refers to UN institutions. It also refers to the Bretton Woods institutions. So if the world will be moving towards multipolar world order, UN reforms will happen. UNSA reforms will occur. All the reforms which we wanted in UN, which I discussed in ICJ, in peacekeeping missions also I'll be discussing, all such reforms will be more likely in a multipolar world order, because US will not be the only country which will be exercising influence. Decisions will be more plural. When it will be more plural, what will happen is it will not be US influence, it will not be purely US liberal ideology. New issues will come up. The interests of the developing world also will be taken into account. Bretton Woods institutions will change. Bretton Woods institution quota reforms will occur. There will be representation of the developing countries. WTO will be more favorable to developing countries. The idea of special and differential treatment will be established. So these are the advantages of multipolar. And if in that case also, what will happen, many new organizations will come up which will challenge all this and will create a truly more multipolar world. For example, BRICS is one alternative. Many such organization will come up which will give a voice to the developing countries. So these are the advantages of multipolar world. NGO role will increase in a multipolar world. So what will happen, nation state won't be the sole authority. War conditions will be less likelier. NGOs working in the field of peace, denuclearization effects will occur. So this way it could be a possibly more stable and a more peaceful world. Next is global issues will acquire importance. Till date, what had happened in under US hegemony and Cold War, those issues which were favorable to US and USSR, those were brought up in as global issues. But after multipolar world, issues like environment, which are issues of the island states, which are issues of the developing countries, gender issues, democracy, human rights, nuclear proliferation, all these issues will be the major issues which will be dealing with, and hence cooperation will be possible. War will become less likely. So these are the advantages of multipolar world is what you're explaining. Next is, despite having advantages, it has its disadvantages also. That part you have to also explain. So disadvantages, realist Kenneth Waltz is the person who dislikes multipolar world. So in a sense, whatever realism is talking about becomes the disadvantages. Realists say that multipolar world is more risk prone, it is more prone to miscalculations, because the definition of realists of a nation state is what they believe, that nation states are dark. Leaders are dark. They are always warmongering. Nation states are warmongering. So more number of states, more risks and more miscalculation. Hence, for them, what they say is they give a dire prognosis of multipolar world. In case multipolar world comes into existence, it will be more risky, it will be more prone to miscalculations, it will lead to chaos and anarchical conditions impacting international governance. So the premise of both realists and liberals is the same. There will be multiple number of actors, but the conclusion which they are coming to is different. So what you are writing, what was the stand you are taking, the success or failure of a multipolar world depends on its composition. When you say depends on its composition, what does it mean? What kind of NGOs are coming up? What kind of nation states are coming up? Whether it is how nation states are behaving, how international institutions are behaving, how institutions are strong or not, whether it is led by a single country. So all those determine how a multipolar world functions, whether it is advantages or not. So the advantage or the success or failure depends on the constituent elements and the principles that govern the multipolar world. So if principles are truly implemented in the right spirit, then it could become a better world, is what you are concluding at the end. So I have told you, a new dimension is being explored. Also, more importantly, it's a mix of theory and practice, an amalgam of theory and practice. I've mentioned this in nuclear deterrence also. They are mixing theory and practice questions, checking whether you have learned theories by rote or you actually know the theory by linking it with certain current examples or certain examples in practice. Next is discuss the importance of personal data protection in the context of human rights. Now, this is a very advanced level question. This is has been asked as part of contemporary global concerns, human rights. So under this, what it is trying to what are the keywords under this? So first it is asking the, about it's a current event, data related question or issue was in news. So data with respect to European data protection regulation was in news, and also India had its own Sri Krishna committee, etc. That is why this question has been asked. So how this data is related to human rights is what it is asking. So human rights is mentioned in a syllabus. They have taken a current event and mixed with the theory. So how do you answer this? First thing is, in the first part, talk link human rights and data. What is the relation between human rights and data? So what is a human right? Human rights refer to the rights of a person because you get certain rights based on a specific condition. So human rights are those rights of a person which he or she enjoys just because of the fact that he is a human being. So when you are saying human rights, etc., how it is linked with the idea of data? So what I'm trying to say is my human rights are related to my identity. So because human being or human is an identity of a human being. So the human rights basically emerge from this identity called human being. Human rights emerge from this identity called the human being. So data is involved in the creation of identity, yes or no? So today, every kind of activity is occurring or is through IT. For example, I am buying something. So when I buy something, I am expressing a choice of mine. So as a consumer, I am expressing a choice. When I make a statement on Facebook or I share something on a social media or a social platform wherein I have criticized the government, this shows my political ideology. It talks about my political taste. So data is nothing but a personality today. Data about me constitutes my personality. So inextricably, data reflects your personal choice, your taste. It forms the personality of an individual. In today's world, when did this actually emerge? This emerged from 1960 when data became important. Globalization was rooted in information technology. That is when the integrated circuit was first time devised. When it was after that, data becomes very important. So today data is called as the new oil. So you are linking two things. First, you are defining human rights. Second is how data is related to human rights. And third point, what you're writing is how data becomes a prominent entity after 1960s. So these are the points you're writing, and hence protection of data becomes important to protect the personality of an individual and also to protect the human right. So part one and part two have explained evolution of importance of data is nothing but 1916 onwards when data is the new oil. So West Asian politics was determined by oil. Today the world politics will be determined by something called data is what you're trying to write. Now part three, what are the possibilities in case data is not protected, how data misuse of data will impinge on the fundamental rights. So here is where you have to show your creativity and ingenuity, where you have to mix theory along with the practice related aspects, that is examples. So first is, if your right is not protected, it will lead to individual attacks, it will lead to invasion of privacy, and privacy is a fundamental right under fundamental right given under Puttaswamy judgment in 2017. Second is, when your data is out, if it is not protected, you have no control over it, people may form biased opinions towards you. Suppose my data talks about my sexual expression, suppose, or sexual orientation. So suppose I am a homosexual. In that case, if my data is leaked, or if my data is as a person, so it's a matter of privacy for me, and if it is released without my voluntary consent, people may form judgment, my life may become difficult in the society. So societal oppression may lead to impinging on human rights. Who talks about societal oppression? It is J.S. Mill who talks about societal oppression. He calls tyranny of the majority. So my opinions, or I may constitute a minority, and data, if it is not protected well, I may become prone to societal oppression. And it is Mill who speaks about this long back, and Mill's terror or Mill's prognosis which he makes may become a reality is what you're writing in case the human rights is not protected. So this is one kind. So individual level attack, society attack. Third is state. So who stores the data? It is the state which actually stores the data, but it is a long forgotten idea that nation state is completely benevolent. State governments or governments in themselves have not been benevolent many a times. State have acted against the individual things. So this could lead to, if your data is not protected and state has complete access to your data, it could lead to state surveillance. They could actually be nosy, they can spy on you, they could know your political preferences, how people vote. This could entirely overturn democracy, it could become a managed democracy. So here the idea of Locke is very relevant. Locke says that state should be a fiduciary. He is the first person to talk about the idea of fiduciary, which I'll discuss at the end. Next is, in case your data is with eminences, there are also human rights possible. So here, what right is affected under human rights? The political right, that is your voting right, management of democracy, political rights like Article 19, etc., where freedom of speech and expression and formation of association, etc., is affected. Next is MNCs. If MNCs have data, what it could lead to? They know what I consume. They know my consumer taste. What it could lead to? It could lead to create. So when the MNCs are using this data to create newer and new products depending on the wants of a person. So they are not catering to needs. They are creating newer and newer wants. This leads to a one-dimensional man. This is the criticism given by Marxist paradigm. So in a sense, data helps in oiling capitalism, and it prevents capitalism from collapsing. When will it collapse? When you restrict your needs, you say this is what I need, but capitalism does not end there. It creates wants after wants. This is what one-dimensional man speaks about. It and Habermas also speaks about how new kinds of wants are created. Erwin Habermas speaks about new kinds of wants, and also Herbert Marcuse speaks about one-dimensional man. So basically what you're trying to say is MNC's control over data leads to creation of one-dimensional man, and it will promote consumerism. It may also lead to puppet states under MNCs. Last is e-colonization. This is at the international framework. Which countries are more or stronger in information technologies? It is the developed countries. So there is a big divide that between the north and the south, or the developed and the developing countries. So what it could lead to is, it could lead to control of the developing countries by the developed countries. For example, today China is considered as a major threat because it is very strong in IT, and many countries have express apprehensions. So one country may become a colony of other country through this data. This is a new form of colonization which has been described called e-colonization. So this is a concern expressed by post-colonial thinkers, a form of new colonization on the data. So these are the problems of human rights, or these are the problems of data if it goes unprotected. So coming to the final part, that is part four of this question, that is, when once you have explained how, what are the problems which could emerge, you also have to explain the mechanisms to protect it. So the mechanisms to protect is what? Give the theoretical principle first. A Locke theory gives you the theoretical principle to protect data. Locke is the first person to say that state should be a fiduciary. So when you say something is a fiduciary, what you're trying to mean is fiduciary is a manager of something. So state is a manager, it is not a own, it is not a not a owner. So what you are saying is, someone who collects data, it could be any authority, it could be an MNC, it could be an individual, it could be a state, it could be an NGO, it should act as a fiduciary. It is not the owner of my data, it is just the manager and protector of data. And based on this principle, only EDPR has made rules, European Data Protection Regulation. Sri Krishna Committee also has given its recommendations. So some recommendations also you could give to prove that theory. For example, right to be forgotten, purpose limitation, meaning the data should be used for only for that purpose, data localization, cross-border transfer, etc., how it should be restricted. All those points you can mention, but theory is also important. Locke's theory you have to mention as the basis. Now this question is, what if you look at the observations here, first is current, it is inspired, data related question linked with human rights. For me, this is a more important. Theory and practice questions are being mixed. It's a question of a higher order. It may seem easy, you may write as an answer, but unless you have mixed theory and practice, you are going to get less marks, because this question is a general studies question. You can put this question, if you put this question verbatim into internet security, people will take it as GS question. So when you say it is a GS question, how do you answer there differently? There you're writing the same points, you're talking about data e-colonization, you're talking about privacy, etc., but you're not talking about thinkers or theories, you're not talking about post-colonialism, you're not talking about Marxism, you're not talking about liberalism, Locke, J.S. Mill, tyranny of society, etc., nothing. But here you're talking about theory. Theory is important here. Theory and practice mix is very important. Now here, this is when you talk about the trend here, what UPSC is trying to do is, UPSC is checking whether you have learned theories by rote, or you know theories in or you have understood theories and are trying to apply in day-to-day life, because you're not going to become armchair philosophers or ivory tower philosophers. You'll be public administrators who should be having the ingenuity to apply theoretical aspects in your daily life, in your daily administration. Moving to the next question, fourth question. First is, how are the rising powers challenging the USA and Western dominance in IMF and World Bank? So this question is from International Political Order and Evolution of International Economic System, that is from Bretton Woods to WTO. Basically, it is asking about the Bretton Woods institution. So its question is, rising powers challenges to the Western dominance in IMF and World Bank. So part one will be an introduction about Bretton Woods and its US and Western dominance in it. So talk about Bretton Woods institution established in 1944, gold standard, Bretton Woods standards emerged out of it, and it entered the second phase in 1970 when Washington consensus emerged. So this is the general. Bretton Woods mainly includes World Bank and IMF. So these are the specific details you're talking about. So first, 1944 phase two, talk about the Washington consensus in 1970s. So this is the first aspect you're talking about. Then talk about its dominance. Now generally students write dominance in the recent context, like it is the directors of both World Bank and also the WTO, they are determined by UK and Europe and US. That is the general point they're writing. But as a Paul Sen student, you should be writing dominance since its inception, not today. So talk about dominance since its inception. 1944, it is a US managed, or it's a US initiative. And more importantly, when do you get an idea of it being a US initiative? When US withdrew from the gold standard, Bretton Woods system collapsed in the event of oil shock, and that is when US takes further initiative of Washington Consensus. That is when Bretton Woods enters first, second phase. So phase one, phase two, withdrawal of phase one, all was part of US hegemony, was an extension of US hegemony. Structural adjustment programs under 1970s Bretton Woods program, structural adjustment program imposed on Chile first, the first country, later on in many different countries including Russia, that is also an extension of US hegemony. And the entire Bretton Woods was not, and the institution was not according to the idea of Keynes. Keynes said that there should be an international currency called banker, but there was gold standard which is instituted, and dollar became the value against which gold standard was measured. Hence, it was US dominance again, because dollar currency became the hard currency there. Next is leadership. The entire leadership of World Bank and IMF is managed between Europe and US even today. Weighted voting. Unlike in WTO, where IMF and World Bank have, I think it is at WTO once, it is IMF and World Bank. Weighted voting is there in World Bank and IMF. In WTO there is one country, one vote. So weighted voting is according to the size of the economy, and US and the developed countries have more say in weighted in such kind of a voting. And despite repeated attempts or repeated demands for reforms, in quota reforms, they have been impervious. They have not shown much interest in Bretton Woods reforms. So this is the evidence of dominance you are giving. The second part of the answer, where you are writing about the challenges. In challenges, the difference you are going to make in writing answer is you are not writing just the immediate challenges or the current challenges. You are looking at the historical aspects as well. So you have to talk about the challenges in phase one, challenges in phase two, then coming to the recent challenges with emerging countries. So phase one challenge, if you look at, Bretton Woods had faced challenges since its very inception. Asian Clearing Union was the union proposed by Iran in 1974, and as a result, an alternative currency was proposed countering the Bretton Woods standard. So this was one challenge which came up. In phase two, there were many challenges. Washington Consensus faced many challenges. One is new international economic order proposed by the developing countries, South-South cooperation, Zapatistas. Zapatistas are a group of people in Mexico, tribal group. The group is named after their leader, Emiliano Zapatista. This group established a military front called the Emiliano Zapatista Liberation Front. This was against the Washington's consensus, and this protested, or they were influenced by the Marxist and the anarchist ideals, and they fought against the NAFTA agreement. So these were all the challenges in with respect to the historical challenges. Now if you look at the challenges in the recent times, where emerging countries like China, India, Brazil, Russia, etc. are posing challenges. The first challenge came in 2000 in the form of Chiang Mai Initiative. So this is an initiative after the 1997 Asian financial crisis. After this, what happened is a group of countries, ASEAN plus 3, Japan, South Korea and China, these countries came together and formed an initiative. This is kind of local swap arrangement, local currency swap arrangement. This is again a threat to the dollar standard which was under Bretton Woods. After that, G20 becomes the biggest challenge. Starting in 1999 it starts, but the biggest challenge it poses is after 2008, because in 1999 when it was established, people did not take it seriously, because then it was the Asian crisis which had happened. Developed countries did not face a big challenge. In 2008, when the financial crisis was hugely affecting developed countries, it is then the developing countries' views were accommodated. So G20 comes as a big challenge. There was one summit which was held after 2008 crisis in 2009 called the Pittsburgh Summit at London. This summit talks about Bretton Woods reforms. It also talks about establishment of a forum called Financial Stability Forum. Financial Stability Forum is nothing but it works in the field of macroeconomic management, the macroeconomic framework of the world. This is nothing but it is saying to the IMF that your role is not proper, your role has not been convincing enough, so we are proposing an alternative forum called Financial Stability Forum. Next is the biggest challenge for Washington Consensus of Bretton Woods institution is China. China has developed its own model. It did not accept the structural adjustment program. It develops a unique model of economy based on domestic consumption, external trade, and manufacturing capacity, artificial management of currency. So this in itself acts as a challenge to Bretton Woods institutions. In recent times, it is bringing new challenges through its OBR, and through OBR, it is trying to propose an alternative globalization. So it is also called Globalization 4.0. 3.0 was after 1991 collapse of USSR. So this OBR is referred to as that. When such a reading is made, what it is saying that it is a challenge to the Bretton Woods institution, and certain institutions as part of OBR have been constituted, like Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. So these banks are considered as an alternative working models to Bretton Woods institutions, and it has its own currency swap model with Russia and currency swap agreements with Russia. So all these are indicators of Chinese revolt against Bretton Woods institutions. The most important regional organization which emerged as a challenge to Bretton Woods institution is BRICS in the form of New Development Bank. Fortaleza Summit of BRICS established an alternative model called the New Development Bank. It also has its own currency reserve assets, the same as the currency swap agreement, but it is among a regional grouping, among the five countries, not bilateral. Next is, many important challenges came in the form of demands made in Bretton Woods. After 2008 financial crisis, many countries demanded that there should be Bretton Woods 2.0. So as a result, the World Bank and IMF could not remain as impervious as earlier. They had to respond. Some kind of quota reforms happened. So conclusion, what are you writing? So challenges. So the question is basically asking about what are the emerging challenges. So what the analytical or the conclusion part will be, what challenges are many, challenges have emerged, alternative models have emerged, but there is still yet a credible alternative to a credible alternative to Bretton Woods institution is yet to emerge. Still we do not have a credible alternative. What we could at best do is work towards Bretton Woods reforms, which gives a equal position to the developing countries. So such kind of a conclusion you can write. Next is, so with this we have ended the last question, 4A. Next, 4B, write an essay on new social movements in developing countries, placing it in the syllabus, which it is part of comparative politics again. It is asking one aspect only, in developing countries, write an essay on the nature of new social movements. So this can be placed in politics of representation and participation. When you talk about participation, there could be different kinds of participation. You participate through a political party or a pressure group, social movement is also a kind of participation. It was an expected question as well, because many social movements were in news, LGBT was in news, Me Too movement was in news. So when you write an answer on new social movements in developing countries, first is you have to write in part one, you have to write the theoretical aspect, as it is part A. Even if it is part B, you have to give some theoretical aspect, but in part A, you have to prove your skills in theory. So first is, when you're talking about social movement, new social movement, talk about the historical aspect of it. It is new social movement because it deals with new issues, and this is a movement which has gone beyond class. After 1960s, World War it started. Vietnam War was the first, Vietnam was the trigger for new social movements. That is when students across different countries, that is European and US, they came together to fight for a specific cause. So that was the first movement wherein people went beyond class movement. Class movements were particularly the new old issues. So they were called old social movements, and new social movements were different. So what are new social movements? Basically, their attribute is what they are fighting for, not for material issues. They are fighting for identity issues, basic issues of dignity. So LGBT issue is not about identity. It's not about material issues. It's about basic dignity and basic identity issues. And anyone can participate in this. It's not restricted to a particular group. A particular person who is interested in the issue of LGBTs or who is interested in the problems of LGBTs, he can participate. There is no limit for it. There is no national boundary limit. There is a third point of it. Fourth is, they are new social movements, have apprehensions with respect to political parties. They do not like to associate with political parties because they have to fight state power, and hence they do not associate with political parties, unlike the old social movements wherein they associate with political parties. And new social movements have very decentralized form of organization, usually led by NGOs, etc. When you look at LGBT movement, it was led by NAS Foundation, Hums of Trust. So these are the attributes. Ideological basis of new social movements is what? Anarchism, libertarianism, young monks, that is the humanitarian Marx, human who talks about human emancipation, and it is also influenced by existentialism. It is also influenced by phenomenology. So these are the ideologies: phenomenology, existentialism, anarchism. You have young Marx, and you also have libertarianism. So these are the ideologies influencing new social movements. Once you have given a strong idea, so these are based on the idea of post-materialism. So Engelhardt talks about post-materialism. So these are the ideas you are giving here. Examples of new social movements are environmental movements, LGBT movements, identity-based movements, women movements are all new movements. So after this, in part to explain about developing countries. So developing countries, there are two kinds of developing countries. One is where there are democratic setups. In certain countries, there is no democratic setup. So divide your answer in that on this basis. So it will be a more holistic answer. The first is developing countries, countries in transition who have democratic setup. So here, if you look at what are their attributes of social movements in developing countries. In developing countries, new social movements did not begin as early as 1960s. They started later. First, they emerged in developed countries, because to have new social movements, you have to go through the old issues first. Your material issues should be fulfilled first, then only you'll go for post-material issues. So world over, it was generally 1960s, but in India and developing countries, it started in 1970s. For example, Rajni Kothari very clearly says that Indian new social movements emerged in 1970s. So that statement also you can give. Next is, if you look at the example, I mean, talk about developing countries, new social movements, give the examples. So take one, take three, four movements, explain them in detail and explain their nature also. For example, you can talk about women movements in India which emerged in 1970, environmental movements in India which emerged in 1970, LGBT movement which emerged in 1994 after the formation of Humsafar Trust. Later on, NAS Foundation takes it up. The entire legal issues and judiciary's decision you can talk about. So when you're talking about all this, when talk about what were the new features in them, what was the new feature in women movement? The issue was new. They were talking about dignity. Any person who's interested in women can participate in it. It was not restricted to a particular, for example, Me Too movement. It was an international movement. So these are the points you're speaking about, trying to prove how women movement is a new social movement, how environmental movement is a new social movement, LGBT movement is a new social movement. This is very easy, because once I've given the theory, take up each point and explain how LGBT movement, for example, LGBT movement is a new social movement. Why do you think so? Because NGO was involved, and it is involved with issues of basic identity, basic dignity and identity. They did not associate with any political parties, and they were post-material nature. So these are the ideas you are giving. But after that, part three, you are explaining where all these movements completely new. Were there any old features? So what you have to explain is, new social movements were not completely new. There were certain old features also, is what you are trying to explain. Because the question is asking, and is asking to write an essay on it. It is asking to analyze the entire nature of new social movements in developing countries. So in old features, there were some old features in this new social movement. For example, women movement, Me Too movement had many old features. It was not completely inclusive. It was a classist movement. It was a women of middle classes who were tech savvy. Those people participated. The issues of SC women, ST women, peasant women or rural women was never taken up. They did not form a major part of women's Me Too movement. So this is an old feature. environmental movement in India didn't were not completely new, because environmental movements were not completely issues of identity and dignity. There was something called livelihood associated. For example, if you take Chipko movement, Apiko movement, all these were people who participated in it, where their livelihood was associated with these forests. So there were material issues also as part of it. And also I have to say is, second part of this answer will be, in the third part, there is a sub-part you have to also talk about. In India, it was not purely new social movement, old social movements also coexisted. So we had caste movements, we had class movements going on. Dalit Panther movement was there. Dalit Panther movement in 1980s, new farmer movement had certain old features. So old social movements still coexisted. Class movements continued, caste movements continued, tribal movements continued. So those old movements continued is what you are saying. So that shows that India or developing countries are a countries in transition. Now after this, part 4 talk about certain countries, developing countries, where there is poor democracy. In case it is a poor democracy, what happens? Movement in itself will not be strong. Movement will still be confined to those old issues like material issues, corruption or better livelihood. So these are the areas or these are the movements which are more prominent in countries like West Asia. So material issues are very predominant in those countries. So what you're trying to say is new social movements in developing countries are three kinds. First is there are new social movements but not completely new. Second is there are new social movements but old social movements also coexist. But there are certain countries where there is no concept of new social movements still date, because they are still restricted to those older ideas, or they have not achieved those old generation rights, what we call as the political rights, economic rights, better livelihood or political rights, right to vote, etc., is not still rightly established. African countries and West Asian countries is what you can talk about. So with this, we have finished this. Next is democracy promotion in developing countries a feasible idea? This is again part of contemporary global concerns. One observation which I'm going to make in all this is the number of contemporary global concerns has dramatically increased. I think there are certain 4 questions given. So where they are focusing in those areas which are purely dynamic, where students or UPSC aspirants do not focus much. So which are those areas and all, we'll outline, then I'll give you inputs at the end as well. So with respect to what it is asking, is democracy promotion in developing countries a feasible idea? So it is again a slightly comparative idea only, but it is taking one issue, democracy. Basically, this entire debate was proposed and propounded. He was the first person to bring this. It was Samuel Huntington who talks about whether democracy promotion should be done or not. So you can introduce with this same statement Samuel Huntington is the first person who talks about the feasibility of democracy promotion. Now when you talk about democracy promotion, or since it is part A, there is a theory associated with it, so you have to speak about the theory. So theoretical and historical basis of democracy promotion, what do I understand by this in part 1? What is that theory which tells you that democracy is the ideal thing and hence democracy should be promoted in all countries, including the developing countries? So that theory you have to establish. So first theory which comes up is under Kant, that is, which later on becomes the democratic peace theory. Meaning, democratic peace theory says what? It says that wherever there is democracy, there is less likely of wars, there is more peace, and hence democracy had to be, was considered as the ideal form of government, and hence it was considered mandatory for every political system to be democratic. This idea was proposed by Kant, but Kant did not support the forcible imposition. He just talks about the importance of democracy. Later on, Michael Doyle in recent times, he takes up this theory and develops into a full-blown thesis, that is democratic peace theory. After this, the most important theoretical basis for democracy promotion is End of History, given by Francis Fukuyama, wherein he speaks about the collapse of USSR and talks about the victory or triumph of liberal democratic order, and liberal democratic orders as is the ideal form of government, and hence it should be promoted all over. So this forms the theoretical basis. Now considering this theory as the basis, US also starts implementing this or starts promoting this. So after 1991, US goes for aggressive promotion of democracy, and that is when this entire debate comes up. So this is the basis you are giving in the first thing. So theoretical and historical basis of democracy promotion. part two, what are you talking? Why promotion is not a feasible idea? There are certain philosophical problems. There are also certain practical problems in why practical problems in promoting or promotion of democracy in developing countries. First is, democracy of the present world is ideologically narrow. What do you understand by this? Today's democracy or promotion of democracy is US kind of democracy. It is ideologically prejudiced. So what happens through that? Democracy of UN within is democratic, but it is illiberal outside. It has not shown liberalism. It has not shown toleration or exhibited toleration to other countries. Any new idea has never been. So if you look at their role in West Asia, today's West Asian politics or the West Asian imbroglio or West Asian, the entire idea of terrorism is a product of US actions. US is to blame. US illiberal ideas are to blame. Second is its impact on international institutions. If you promote democracy of this kind today, it will be US dominated democracy. What will happen? The international institutions will not be working in favor of the developing countries. They will become US mandated institutions, and what will happen is those will be ideologically prejudiced institutions. And for example, the best example we can give is narrow definition of human rights. Today's human rights is US human rights. So US ironically has been the greatest violator of human rights outside US. So it respects human rights within its country, but not the same standards are applied outside. So this has been disastrous. The entire issue of terrorism which has emerged today is an outcome of all this, the failure of international institutions. So this is where you are saying that it's ideologically narrow. Second point which you are proving is US promotion was disastrous. For example, in West Asia it was disastrous. It has led to the most famous theory, that is civilizational conflict, and which talks about emergence of terrorism, that is Christianity versus Islam. East Asian conflicts also you can talk about. Same civil conflict of civilization given by Huntington himself says that how East Asia emerged as a challenge to democracy promotion by US. For example, when there was human rights proposed, UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, there was consequently Asian values proposed by the East Asian countries. So that was in 1993, Asian values, there was a summit held when Vienna Convention was held at the same time. So this people did not accept it. This was a new challenge. So what happened was, in West Asia and East Asia, democracy promotion did not lead to democracy. Many a times dictatorship got the best out of it. They started exercising authoritarian rule in those countries because they sent a message to the people there saying that in case it is not authoritarianism, US is going to attack you. So they need authoritarianism in order to protect their local culture, was what was promoted. So this has been disastrous. Next is one more idea of promotion which was promoted in countries, in decolonized countries, particularly Africa. It has not worked very well because what has happened is there has emerged a phenomenon called ballot obsession. Ballot democracy used by Larry Diamond, and this entire phenomenon is spoken about by Fareed Zakaria when he talks about illiberal democracy, wherein what he says is, in decolonized countries, democracy which has been imposed has led to a kind of ballot obsession. What do you understand by this? There is just frequent elections with no real democratic culture. People do not know about civic rights. People do not have a civic culture. People do not have a strong political culture. What is democracy there? It is just elections after elections, and that too, those elections are held because the rulers want some kind of legitimacy. And all these democracies are somewhere remotely controlled by one of the developed powers. So talk about how it has led to ballot obsession, how no real democratic culture has been established. So what does this all lead to when you talk about the entire essence, ideologically narrow, US promotion in West Asia, East Asia, US democratic movements, certain indirectly supported democratic movements even in Arab countries, the recent Arab Spring also you can speak about, how they did not lead to any feasible change. After this, summarize the entire idea by talking about how this kind of a promotion impinges on the freedom to devise own systems. What does it mean? when decolonization happened, or any country has its own freedom to devise its own political system, but there are certain human values and human rights every country has to respect, but it has its own self-determination right. So any kind of promotion or imposition by the developed countries is a violation of this. So post-colonial thinkers criticize this kind of imposition by the developed countries. Now, then we have to talk about, if not promotion, what is needed? Promotion is needed, but it should be UN mandated promotion. For that, UN should be neutral. So if UN has to be neutral, all international institutions have to be neutral. What is required is a cosmopolitan democracy. So cosmopolitan democracy refers to wherein all international institutions are plural in nature, all countries have voices in them. This is a concept given by David L. So once you establish strong institutions, democracy promotion will become neutral and not ideologically prejudiced. After that, you can talk about, you should be promoting democratic culture rather than just elections. So what is democratic culture? People's political socialization, understanding of civic rights, what are rights, what is their role as a citizen, etc. This is democratic culture. So democratic or public vigilantism is what is need to be developed so that democratic culture remains strong. So this is a kind of bottom-up approach, not imposed externally. So this is cultivation of awareness regarding the fundamental rights or human rights and democratic rights. Finally, what you're ending is a conclusion based on the philosophy of promotion. So what you're trying to say is democracy may be the most efficient political system today, but one should not be oblivious to the new innovations, because today we may consider democracy is the best form, but as the world progresses, as we may see new form of indigenous systems. So we should, when the promotion is being done, we should never be oblivious to the fact that democracy is just for today. Maybe new institutions may come up. If you are not in promoting democracy with this idea and are not open to new political systems, it will violate the democratic spirit. So what I have said is that is, you have to keep the democratic spirit alive. That is, new system should be allowed to promote, else it will become despotism of democracy. So what is this idea? This is a postmodern idea which says that nothing is the final form, nothing is the final truth. There may come new institutions. So even if you are promoting, promote it in a liberal fashion, keeping your mind open for newer and newer systems. For example, in India itself, you have certain kind of indigenous panchayat system. Gandhi had the foresight to give such an idea. And in case you are oblivious to this fact that developing countries can have their own systems, in that case what will happen? It will lead to despotism of democracy. So these are the points with respect to this question. Now, with this we have completed part A of the paper. Hi everyone. I thought of doing the entire discussion in a single go, but when I actually finished the discussion, I realized that it has become a bit longer. It became a video of 4 hours. So I thought of dividing it into 2 parts. With this video, I finished the first part, part A discussion of paper 2. And part B discussion I'll be doing in a separate video, and the video will be released along with this itself. In part B, or in the second video where I'm discussing part B, I've ended the video with overall observations on the paper and also the overall strategy for the paper in general for political science as to what you should be doing next for your upcoming examinations. So this is, do watch it together, because this is how you will get a holistic understanding of how the paper has changed and what you should be doing. Hope you like it. Thank you. Have a great day. Thank you.